love and respect. Today I'll try to present a few words about an extraordinary scientist is a real scientist of the inner world. He's an extraordinary scientist of the inner world. Few words about his life and his message. His name is Patanjali. One of the great enlightened masters of India. Actually, these few talks are going to be a series of talks on him, on his message. We remember him because he created one of the wonderful book, or we can say great book, book of books. He created a book which is the root for millions of books. He created the formula or aphorisms for whole spiritual philosophy, for whole spiritual world. All spiritual literature can be classified into three categories. One is which expresses the goal, what you need to achieve. These books are called philosophy books, more intellectual, that will be explaining about what is truth, what is life, what happens after death. These subjects are discussed in that books, the philosophy books. We call in Sanskrit Shastra. The philosophy books speak about what happens after death, what is Atman. These philosophy books, they speak about what is the truth beyond the life and death, all these things. They are more intellectual stuff. The difficulty is the philosophy is not method or a technique to transform your life. It is just an experience of a philosopher or perception of a philosopher. You can't even say experience, perception of a philosopher. So it can vary from person to person. See, from person to person, the perception varies. This one question, what happens after death? You can say millions of people have answered this question. Still the question is virgin. Millions have answered this question. Still the question is virgin. Still we don't know the answer. Whomsoever tried to answer this question created one philosophy on the planet Earth. Whomsoever tried to answer this question, he created one philosophy on the planet Earth. One part of spiritual literature is philosophy, which speaks about what happens after death, what is life, what is the purpose of life, what is soul, all these things. What is sin and what is merit, all these things. There is the next kind, second level, literature. Songs in praise of God. Literature which is praising the glory of God. The first level is for intellectual, second level is for emotional people. First level is for intellectual people. Second level is for emotional people. Just singing about the glory of the God, praising the glory of the God, and more or less fairy tales. First level, intellectual, is also not for a common man. Second level, emotional, that is also not for a practical man. Third kind of literatures, spiritual literatures, which is for man who is asking for solution, who wants solution, the man who is in being level, solid down to earth man, who is a seeker, who wants clear-cut experience of spirituality. The third level literatures are called sutras, means the aphorisms are techniques to reach that spiritual experience. First level is shastra, means philosophy, just an intellectual stuff. It'll be very nice when you read, not for practicality. Beautiful story from Socrates' life. One young guy, youngster, goes to him and asks him, "Sir, what do you suggest? Should I marry?" Socrates had a terrible wife. She used to beat him. And all his philosophy is only outside the house, not inside the house. Inside the house, simply he has to listen. He can't speak. This guy goes to him and asks, "Sir, should I marry? What do you suggest?" Socrates says, "You should marry." This guy, the young guy, asks him, why are you insisting me? Why are you asking me to marry? I know for sure that your marriage life is not a happy life. Your marriage is not successful. Why are you asking me to marry?" Socrates replies beautifully, "See, only two things can happen. One, you may have a good wife, good life, that's nice, good for you. Or you may have like mine. Even if that happens, you will become a philosopher. Good for the country. So in both the way, it is going to be good. If it is good wife, it is good for you. If otherwise, it is good for others. So naturally, it is going to be good." Actually, this story is not only a joke, this has got some meaning in it. The people who are not happy in their life create philosophies. I tell you really, people who are not happy, down to earth, straight, practical, they create philosophies. Philosophy is nothing but complicating the simple truths. If you learn the knack or technique, how to complicate the simple truth, you can become a philosopher. The more the ability to complicate, the more your name and fame. People should feel they understood, but they should not understand. If they understand, your business is gone. It's almost like the psychiatric medicines. They will cure you, almost, but not fully. Philosophy is almost like that. The more you read, more it will only create questions. Philosophy can never give solutions. Philosophy is a beautiful way to postpone your questions. Not to get answers, just to postpone. Till you read another philosopher, you will think you got the answer. For example, you take this one question, what happens after death? Read one philosopher's answer. You will feel totally contented and you will experience as if you got the answer. Only till you touch another one philosopher's book. The moment you get another one philosopher's book and try to read his answer, all your answers will be shaken up. Everything is gone. Now you have to start from beginning. The more philosophy, more confusion. I have always seen people who somehow manage the technique of complicating simple things, create philosophies. It's one kind of literature. The next, again, almost fantasies. Oh God, you are beautiful, you are graceful, you are this, you are that. The morning discourse I was studying, it's very easy to love the world, but very difficult to love your neighbor or wife. Same way, it is very easy to love the God because he is somewhere, no problem. But very difficult to love the person who is in front of you, the person who is with you. Our concept of God is too vague. Too vague. It is not a straight reality which can enrich your life, which can transform your life. So all our emotional expressions of God, about God, is nothing but our unfulfilled fantasies. Of course, some of you may feel a little hurt. What is this? In the great poems of saints, is this an unfulfilled fantasy? We should understand, we should take a little bit of time to penetrate through the human mind and how it works. We should not have any of the prejudice or preconceived ideas when we start inquiring for truth. And this man on whom I am going to speak on these next 4 days, this great man, Patanjali, he says from the first statement, let us inquire into the truth. That's all. Let us inquire into the truth. He starts with this word. So when we inquire into the truth, we should not have a prejudice. We should not have an idea. If somebody is considered as a saint by mass, we shouldn't simply say whatever they have done is right. Maybe right, but not enough. We should be very clear about what we want, or what level we want to reach. Just the praise or the stotras, stotra means just singing the God's name, is good time pass. But how much will it be practical? How much it can transform your life? How much is going to enrich your life? Is it going to make you as a new person? Is it going to solve all the problems of your life? Is it going to give you some life solutions? If you think in this way, honestly, if you start searching, naturally, it is not going to. If you have a little time, just you want to spend in a good way, entertaining yourself, then you can take up some songs. Sing the praise of God. Oh God, you are beautiful, you are great. There are so many songs in so many languages, in so many traditions. Hinduism is filled with stotras, means that praise of God. I don't think any other religion has produced so much of literature in praise of God. I can say at least some 10 million volumes. Please understand, when I say 10 million, I mean 10 million. At least 10 million volumes Hindus have produced in praise of God. Good time pass. In olden days, in India, there was no TV or cinema. No other entertainment is possible. Good entertainment. But if you look a little deep, something more is necessary. Something more needs to be achieved. The philosophy and songs. Philosophy is food for your intellect, brain candy, that's all. And the songs in praise of God, again, is good, but not for the ultimate spiritual experience. They are just goody-goody. The goody-goody people are very nice, but not efficient. And it's good, but not going to lead to the ultimate experience. It is not going to be practical. It's not going to be reality. Here is a literature, the highest form of expression made by great extraordinary scientist Patanjali. The book is called Patanjali Yoga Sutra, means the aphorisms on union with ultimate. Yoga means union with ultimate. Please understand, in the West, yoga means some set of physical exercises. That is what we understand. But the word yoga means union with ultimate energy, union with the ultimate spiritual being, union with God, our universal consciousness. Yoga means, in Sanskrit, literal meaning is union with universal consciousness. He writes sutras, means aphorisms, on how to achieve that universal consciousness. And I've read thousands of spiritual books, but I've not come upon a book which is so scientific, so straightforward, to the core, like this Patanjali's Yoga Sutras. This Patanjali's aphorisms on ultimate experience. I have read even enough of quantum physics books. There is a beautiful movie the other day, it's in the theater. What the bleep do we know? On quantum physics, what the bleep do we know? The title is right. And I tell you, and the another one book I read, The Fabric of Cosmos. After reading all this quantum physics literature, I tell you, honestly, the Patanjali is more practical, more scientific than any of the modern day quantum physicists. I can be sure about that. Patanjali is more practical, more down to earth, more scientific than any of the modern day quantum physicists. Scientist means he needs three qualities, main three qualities. The search for truth, the thirst for truth, seeking. Next thing, analyzing the data without prejudice, without any preconceived idea, without any investment. Third, the courage to go with the conclusion, courage to follow the conclusion which comes from your research. The person who has got these three qualities only can be called as a genuine scientist. If you compromise in any one part, in any one step, we can't, that person can't be called a scientist. Many times, people compromise for their vested interests, for money, or name and fame, or their beliefs, or afraid that we may disturb the common belief. We may disturb the common beliefs of the society and get the wrong name. Maybe due to some reason, if the person compromises in his search or in his analysis, in his research, or in his courage to go behind the truth which he discovered, if he compromises even in one step, he can't be called as scientist. And if you look at from these three points, Patanjali is the extraordinary scientist, the father of yoga system, father of all the yoga system. He is the father of all yoga and meditation. I can say he is the father of all the Eastern religions. Buddha, Mahavira, or Shankara, all these great mystics are outcome, or I can say, only the followers of this great Patanjali. And there are books written about Jesus' life, which sends a strong, which spreads an idea that he was also some way, directly or indirectly, learned the Patanjali's sutras, and many of his teachings directly relate with the Patanjali's yoga aphorisms, especially the books. Now, coming up, that wonderful book, which very controversial book, but we can't deny this book. There are few things which can't be denied is said in that book about the life of Jesus. Any of you have read that book, which has become very popular in the recent days, which says that Jesus got married and he's got lineage and all those things. How do you pronounce? And there are some more books, the last period of Jesus and all those things. Of course, we don't know, still it is not accepted, but there are few statements or a few things we can't deny it completely. In a way, I can say, at least his thoughts have inspired all the great spiritual masters of the planet Earth. Whomsoever happened after Patanjali are surely inspired, are touched by his words, by his thoughts, knowingly or unknowingly. That is sure. After him, he created such a strong energy, such a strong understanding, such a strong way, I can say, he created such a wonderful ways. After him, anybody happened on the planet Earth, any mystic who appeared on the planet Earth, is directly or indirectly is influenced by Patanjali. Maybe they don't know his name, but his ideas are there in the air. People are inspired and practicing his ideas. His ideas have surely inspired and influenced all the mystics who happened on the planet Earth after Patanjali. Patanjali is such an extraordinary man. In his books, you can see all these three qualities. When I call him a scientist, I mean he radiates all these three qualities in the maximum, with the maximum purity. He radiates all these three qualities of openness and research, the search for truth, doing research with an open mind, and courage to go behind the conclusion, not bothering about the social belief or the traditional understanding. When Galileo declared the planet is not flat, there was so much of opposition from many corners, because some religions believed the planet Earth is flat. So people have started opposing, objecting, no, you can't say this round. You have to change. Otherwise, you'll be killed. Then he made a change. And one more statement which people did not like is that some religions believe the sun goes around the planet Earth, and he discovered planet Earth only goes around the sun. So that idea also people did not like. People wanted him to change. Anyhow, in his book he changed that statement. And then below he writes a small footnote. I changed my statement because I belong to your religion. I belong to your faith. But sun or the planet Earth, they are not going to change. They are going to go only as they are moving, because they don't belong to our religion. Sometimes the common interest or the mass, the faith of the mass, also interferes in the scientific research. Here is a great scientist who has done so much of research in the inner world. He starts with a deep quest for truth and does his research with an open mind, without any prejudice, and has got courage to express the truth which he discovered. He is not ready to bend any of his thing for the sake of somebody's understanding. In those days, the kings used to support the spiritual scientists. If the research, the conclusion of the research, if it is not helping the king, if it goes against the vested interests of the king, neither the research can be published nor the scientist will be allowed. In the modern day again, in many fields, people who do research, they have to come upon to a conclusion which funders want. The people who fund, they play a major role, or they play an important place in the conclusions. You can't publish, you can't come upon with any conclusion which disturbs the vested interests of the people who fund your research. Here is a scientist who is totally courageous, who is revolutionary, real revolutionary, who has brought the truth straight away to the planet Earth without any dilution. Scientist is a person who creates formula to reproduce something in the outer world. Anything happens in the outer world, they do research, they try to analyze, they try to contemplate, they create a formula to reproduce the same product or the same thing in the outer world. Mystic is a person who creates a formula to reproduce the same experience which happens in the inner world. If you understand this, Patanjali is the greatest mystic ever happened on the planet Earth. He created such a foolproof, wonderful system. Even after 10,000 years, still the system works. Even after 10,000 years, no updating is done. Please be very clear, softwares only can be updated. Spiritual systems can never be updated. His spiritual tradition, or the book which he created 10,000 years ago, still works, still gives the result, still it is a foolproof. Not only foolproof, and still it is giving the result. Foolproof and straight away gives the result. He's an extraordinary scientist. There are few mystics who happened on planet Earth. They created formulas, techniques to reproduce the same experience which happened to them in the inner world. But those formulas suited only particular mindset. Few people created formulas which will suit only for the intellectual group. Few people created formula which will suit only for emotional people. Few people created a formula which will suit only for men. Few masters created formula which will suit only for women. That's a beautiful book. Men are from Mars and women are from Venus. I was telling about this in a discourse. One person stood up and commented, I disagree with this, Swamiji. I said, why? They can't be from such a close planet as planets. They can't be from such close planets. Maybe the Mars of this universe and the Venus of other universe. Or the Venus of other universe or Mars of this universe. It cannot be from same universe. The distance is so much, it cannot be from same universe. Anyhow, people created formulas, aphorisms to reproduce the spiritual experience only on particular mind setups, on particular people, maybe intellectual or emotional. There are few masters who created techniques to reproduce the experience on the being level people. But here is a person, great enlightened master, mystic, who created techniques to reproduce that spiritual experience in every being. He has created keys to unlock all possible doors. Doors which existed which is existing, which is going to exist. Minds which existed, which is existing, which is expected, are yet to exist. He created a master keys. In his sutra, he says, Sarva Bhaumya Brataha, the Sanskrit word, means these vows are these promises are for the whole world. He gives few promises, few oaths for the whole world. And I tell you, it's not only working in one country. Today, in the modern day, all over the world, is science is practiced. And I was traveling with one professor, a professor who is doing research on this interreligious study, comparative religions. I was asking about the percentage of population, which religion has got what percentage on the planet Earth. He says, Swamiji, do you want the official percentage or practical percentage? I asked him, what do you mean by that? Official percentage or practical percentage? Swamiji, we have two things in our country. Official religion, practicing religion. If you want official, the statistics is different. If you want practical, the statistics is different. If you see in this way, I think Patanjali is the person who has created a religion which is practiced by more number of people on the planet Earth. I can be sure of that. He is the person who created a religion which is practiced by more number of people on the planet Earth. Maybe officially less, because he never created an official institution. He has not created any organization. He has not organized. But in practical sense, if you see, almost all the mystics are influenced directly or indirectly by him. And I read the statistics. At least 25% of Americans have practiced at one form or other yoga and meditation. They say 25%. I was shocked. 25% looks too much. But they say 25% have practiced one form or other yoga or meditation. And one more shocking, but good information, good thing, good news. At least 10% of American population regularly practice some form of yoga or meditation. 10% again. 1 in 10. Practices some form of yoga or meditation. Means more than 25% are practically Patanjaliites. Of course, he never created a religion. He says beautifully, the truth belongs to the universe. Truth belongs to everybody. Sarva Bhaumya Brataha. These truths belong to the whole world. For example, Thomas Alva Edison discovered the light. Just because he discovered, it doesn't mean it belongs to his religion or his community. The moment it is discovered, it belongs to the whole world. The truth belongs to the whole world. God saved in his time, there was no copyright. No trademark. Same way, Patanjali says, he discovered the truths of inner world. Just like Edison discovered the truth of the outer world, light, this light. He discovered the truths about the inner light, enlightenment. He says, I might have discovered it, but it doesn't belong to one religion. It doesn't belong to one community. It doesn't belong to one creed. Nobody can build organization around me. I do not want to be organized. Let it belong to the whole world. He opened up. And he might have discovered, but the truth belongs to the whole world. It doesn't belong to any particular religion, any particular sect, any particular cult, or any particular group. Belongs to the whole world. And he is so great because he has not created an organization. The moment you create the organization, truth is corrupted. The moment you organize the truth, it loses its beauty. I tell you one important thing. The rose, when it is a flower, it really looks beautiful. If you try to make a plastic rose just for the sake of long life, it may look like a rose, but it is not rose. The difference between rose and the plastic rose is the same between the truth and organized religion. Patanjali is so great, he just expressed the truth, never created any philosophy or organization around his truth. That is the reason, even after 10,000 years, these aphorisms, these formulas are giving the result. Because the moment you allow an organized religion, it will get diluted. It will get diluted. There is a great master in India. His name is Jai Krishnamurti. Some of you might have heard him. Heard about his name. Great master. He writes, after creating his organization, he writes a rule. This organization has got only one right. It can preserve my books and publish. It has no right to send any preacher or commentator to speak on my books or message. He says the person who comments creates chaos. The person who expresses without experience creates chaos. And that is true. That is true. If Krishna and Christ, if both of them meet, they will hug each other. They will share their love. But the Krishna's cows and Christ's goats will always fight. If they meet each other, they will only fight. If Krishna and Christ, if they both meet each other, they will hug each other. They will share their love. But this Krishna's cows and Christ's goats, they will only fight. Because they are not experienced. Krishnamurti says beautifully, nobody has got the right to comment on my words, to create a church around me, to create an organization around my teachings. They are enough unto itself. I do not want the truth to be diluted. And Patanjali is one of the extraordinary scientists. He says, I do not want the truth to be diluted. I do not want any organization around my words. The moment you allow the organization to be created, there will be more philosophers and theology people to complicate the philosophy. Because unless you complicate, you can't exploit the people. Unless we complicate, we can't exploit the people. If everybody understands the truth, then what is the use of an organization? So any organization needs to complicate the truth, to copyright, to create trademark, to create service mark. I say about any organization. Somebody asked me the other day, Swamiji, what is the difference between Shankara's teaching and Buddha's teaching? Shankara says, Atman is everything, self is everything. Buddha says, there is no self, anatta. What is the difference between Shankara's idea of Purna and Buddha's idea of Shunya? Shankara says everything, Buddha says nothing. What is the difference between these two? I told them, only one thing. Just, it is a simple problem of copyright. What Buddha says and what Shankara says is one and the same. In experience wise, the Buddha's experience and Shankara's experience is one and the same. Why two different names? Copyright problem, that's all. When Buddha said nothing, Shankara should not repeat the same word because he needs something special. At least Shankara's disciples need something to create an organization. So they create a new word and have copyright. The other day I was reading in one yoga journal, Super Deluxe Kundalini Yoga. Super Deluxe Yoga. I was just shocked. How could this title come? I'm not able to find any corresponding word for the Super Deluxe in Sanskrit. How could this person created this title? How he created the title Super Deluxe Yoga? I told one of our people to ring up and ask. And he says, the word is copyright. It's the same stuff, but you need to have your copyright. So just like that, each one has created their own words. More and more complications. Here is this great scientist, Patanjali, leaves his message or his discovery. It is not even his message, his discovery. And he says very clearly, let there be no organization. Let this truth spread by itself. Somebody asked me a question, Swamiji, but without organization, how to preserve it, Swamiji? Even to preserve this great truth, we need organization. Patanjali says beautifully, if it is truth, it will find its own way to survive. It will survive. If it dies, be very clear, it is not truth. Someday, there may be need for this book to die. Means some more clarity has descended on the humanity. Some higher researches is done. Some better way, much better way the truth is expressed. Maybe at that time, this book has to die. At that moment, better let this book die. It's okay. As long as this is the book of ultimate truth, let it be alive. When something else comes up, updated version, or some updated version of consciousness, if some more updated versions appear, if somebody else who can develop on it, if he brings out something, then let this book die, no problem. I want truth to survive. If I create an organization, even if some more truth is discovered, or if somebody else updates this book, then naturally my disciples or people who belong to my organization will oppose that person. If Krishna comes down again, he will not be allowed in the Krishna temples. Please be very clear. If Buddha comes down, no Buddhist monastery will entertain him. It's true. They will tell, we are doing without you. Please be in your place. They can't, because their Western interest will be shaken. Their Western interest will be shaken. You can do your business as long as the truth is not revealed. He says beautifully, I am not creating any organization so that this book can die when time comes. If it is necessary, if some more updated research are done, if an updated version appears, if somebody expresses in a much better way, let this book die, let that truth prevail. He is not only creating the ultimate technique, and he is leaving the whole thing open so that the next generation can develop upon it. This openness is what makes me call him as a scientist. I can say he is a scientist, saint and scientist. He is both mystic and a scientist together. He is an extraordinary scientist who created wonderful techniques or created a new path to experience the inner world or the ultimate divine spiritual being. And apart from doing a great work, he is so open, he is ready to allow anybody to update him, he is ready to allow anybody else to question him, criticize him, or do anything on his book. But the beauty is, still we are not able to add even a single word to his teachings, to his techniques. Not even a single word could be added, because it is so perfect. Still we are not able to update. Still we are not able to develop. I think he knows it. That is the reason he kept the whole thing open. He is so confident about the stuff which he is delivering. The person is really confident about the stuff which he is delivering only can be so open. Here in this country I saw a few advertisements, beautiful advertisements. Money back guarantee. And guarantee, we beat the best deals. If you get this product lower than this price, come back, we'll give you the same deal. You can say all these words only when you are confident about the product which you are selling. Same way, here is a person so confident about the truth which he is speaking. He is keeping all the doors open. He is inviting, welcoming everybody. They can come and experiment with him, update him, question him, or do research on his work. That is what makes me call him Patanjali, the extraordinary scientist. In these next 4 days, every day I will be speaking on his book, the great book, Patanjali Yoga Sutras. Today, I'll start the initial introduction. In his book, he's almost a spiritual navigator. You know what navigator means? It shows the way. You just type the address and it clearly guides you. And you can ask nearest pizza corner, or nearest lodge, nearest restaurant, nearest hotel, it will take you. Nearest motel, anywhere, it will just take you. Same way, he has created a navigator which will guide you in the spiritual world. Any problem, He has got solution. Anything related to the inner world, mind and body and spirit. In the body, mind, spirit. In this field, anything, he has got solution. And sometimes you will be shocked. How could he give solutions for modern day problems? In modern day we face a lot of problems. Many type of perversions, fantasies. Even for these problems, he gives a clear-cut solution, which is down to earth and practical. And one more thing. The greatness of Patanjali is totally down to earth and practical. He is neither intellectual philosopher nor an emotional singer. He neither creates a philosophy about the goals and the other world, what happens after death, this, that. You can't find a single philosophy line or a line based on which you can create a philosophy in his book. Not even a single impractical theories. Not even a single line which can't be proved. Everything is straight truth. He is not intellectual philosopher. And same way, he is not just an emotional singer. No praise of any god. And I think he is the first atheist. He is the first atheist. Pure atheist. Not fanatic atheist. Please be very clear. We always have a wrong idea. Only for theism, we think only theists are fanatics. Our believers are fanatics. It is wrong. To be an atheist, you need to be more fanatic. To be an atheist, you need to be more fanatic. Because to be a believer, you don't need much. See, to be a believer is very easy. And not only that, it is logically you can see, when you see this world, naturally you have to analyze, there is somebody who created. The very existence of the world is a proof for the creator. Unless there is a creator, there cannot be something called created. So this is enough proof for God or the divine. So naturally, for theism, you don't need to be fanatic. If you just logically analyze, you will be a theist, that's all. You will be a believer, that's all. But to be an atheist, you need strong fanatic attitude. No, even if that is the case, I am not going to believe. You need strong fanatic attitude to be an atheist. To be an atheist, you need a lot of fanaticism. Here is a person who is neither intellectual philosopher nor an emotional singer. He has nothing to do with. He never even opens the topic or subject of belief or faith or whether God exists or not and all these things. All he does is just gives you a simple techniques to realize the ultimate divine experience. That's all. So that we don't have to waste our time in arguing whether God exists or not. Straight away he gives a technique and says experience. In his language, if you have to tell, he says, to know apple is tasty, you neither have to believe or disbelieve. You don't have to argue. Just have a bite. Over. You know it. Same way, you don't have to argue. You don't have to believe it or disbelieve it. Just have a bite. That's enough. What's truth? You will know. He starts with a beautiful word. The first aphorism. The first word is Yogaha Ch. Chitta Vritti Nirodha means yoga is cessation of mind. Yoga is the cessation of mind. Where your mind just drops, that space is called yoga. You achieve the ultimate experience when mind ceases to exist. Where just mind drops, dissolves into the existence. As long as mind exists, you can't experience that union. You will be in dilemma. You will always be in this side and that side, and this side and that side, and this side and that side. I always tell people, jump before you think, because if you start thinking, you will never jump. Jump before you think. If you start thinking, you can never jump. Thinking. If you think, you will think and think. Even if you jump, the moment you jump, you have to stop thinking. Only then you can jump. Person with a mind can only create more and more confusion. He can only dissect and create more categories. Only a person who goes beyond logic, he can experience the union. Only he can unite. The first line, yoga is cessation of the mind. Yogaha chitta vritti nirodaha. Where your thoughts disappear, there union happens. There is no gap between you and divine. Whether you believe it or not, accept it or not, want it or not, you are God. You are divine. All you can do is only one thing. Either you can accept it, experience and express, or you can just continue to struggle and fight. That's all. But the truth is truth. Small story. One guy was informed that is what, how to win friends and influence people. There are so many books. In all those books they say, if at all you want to catch the attention of the audience, you have only 30 seconds. The first 30 seconds is the time they decide about you, over. In the 30 seconds, if you can inspire them, they will listen what you say throughout the class, throughout the program. If you miss the 30 seconds, over. After that, you can't make them listen to you. Because they have decided about you. And in the modern day, 30 seconds is too much, I think. First few words only. In first few words, you decide about the speaker. Then after that, only through, based on your decision, you will be continuously judging him. You will not be listening to him. You will be just judging him continuously based on your opinion. Over. He says in that book, how to sell your ideas in this type of books. They say, in the beginning itself, you have to give some catching point so that people will sit and listen. Here, beautiful thing, Patanjali gives not only the catching point, the whole complete conclusion or the whole thing. The whole book he presents in this one first line. What is yoga? Over. Yoga is cessation of mind. Here he gives three things. the goal, the path, and after achieving, what happens to you. All the three is given in this one line. The goal is union, and the path is dropping the mind. What happens after is the divine experience. All the three is expressed in this one single line. Yoga is cessation of the mind. Yoga ha chitta vritti nirodha. Over. If you drop, you see, the goal is supposed to be the union with ultimate spiritual being, experiencing the ultimate spiritual energy, experiencing the cosmic intelligence, cosmic energy, experiencing the universal energy. That is the goal. And the path is dropping the mind, means going beyond the thoughts. The goal after achieving, what happens is the ultimate experience. All these three is expressed in this one single line. The whole gist of his philosophy, the whole gist of his practical philosophy, we should not understand the word philosophy, the practical philosophy, the whole gist of what he wants to share, he shares in this one single aphorism, this one single sutra, in this one single line. And the whole book is just a commentary on this one single line, that's all. He has written hundreds of lines, but the whole book is commentary on this one single line. Explanation of this one single line. So we will take next few days to analyze and understand what he says about this union, about dropping the mind, and how to drop it, his techniques and his methods and his teachings. We'll take next few days and see in detail. I pray to the ultimate energy, the divine, to shower this understanding on all of us. And I pray to this great master Patanjali to help us to understand his great work and experience the ultimate bliss, the eternal bliss, Nityananda. Thank you. Tomorrow onwards, we will have meditation every day after the discourse. He has spoken on four, he has written four chapters. Every day we will see one chapter and one meditation from that chapter. We will practice. Now, if you want, you can ask any questions, anything related to spirituality or life solutions, you are welcome. We will try to analyze. I'll try to answer. Respond to your questions.
I have just one question.
Yes.
There's no need for what you said about Patanjali.
Yes.
I understood he lived about 2,000 years ago, and you said 10,000 years.
Oh, there's a big controversy going on. Actually, in India, there is a habit. If my disciple writes some book, after even 100 years of me passing away, if he writes some book, it will be attributed to my name. So like that, some people who lived in his tradition wrote some book and they attributed to his name, because based on those books, they say that he lived only 2,000 years ago. But if you see the language of this, the Sanskrit language which is used in this book, is minimum 10,000 years old. Only based on the history of the language we are now able to trace the ages of these great saints. See one thing, India is very weak in the history. They never cared, they never gave importance to the incidents or the happenings. They gave always importance to the philosophy. They gave importance to knowledge. They never gave importance to the day-to-day incidents. So no incident is clearly recorded. And still now, we are not sure of any great master's date of birth or their life, whether Shankara or Buddha or Krishna or Patanjali or no master's life. Because the problem is, that's why in India, the history is called as Purana. Purana means, it is not facts, it is truths. There's a big difference between fact and truth. Fact means what happened, the facts. This is the date, this is the day, this is the time, this incident happened in the material world, over. Truth means the impact of that incident on the human life. They gave more importance to the impact than the incident. So, if somebody happens on the planet Earth and he creates a big impact, then the impact is recorded. Then that thing is recorded. But not the date, time and the facts. They are not given much importance to the fact. That is the reason, all this confusion. They gave always importance only to the truth. To the utility part of incidents, not the fact parts. And it's like one person goes into a mango garden with his friend. His friend starts counting how many branches are there, how many leaves are there, what all the types of mangoes are there, how much we can make money if we also start a mango garden. And all this research he started doing. The other guy, he nicely enjoyed few mangoes and came out. Who is more intelligent? Naturally, the guy who enjoyed the mangoes. So the Indian history, they bothered more about the enjoying mangoes. They bothered more about the impact. They did not much bother about the fact. That's the reason we suffer with this historical things, historical questions. But now they are coming up with a new understanding based on the language. Now they know the history of the language. Based on the history of the language, now they are able to identify. He must have existed in that time. So even then we can say only rough. We are able to say before 10,000 years, maybe 1,000 years earlier, maybe 11,000 or maybe 9,000. That much only we are able to say. We are not able to exactly say when he lived. So based on the history of the language, now they are coming up with an idea, maybe 10,000 years. And moreover, the place where he lived, his tomb is there still. The place is called Rameshwaram in the South India. His tomb is there. So there are few records. And moreover, now they are coming up with a new thing called the based on that stone structure. Based on that structure, now they are able to identify how many thousands of years ago it is done. So based on all these things, they are coming up with an idea, maybe 10,000 years. And the one more problem, all Patanjali's disciples will be called as Patanjali. Patanjali number 2, Patanjali number 3. And after later on, the number misses. Only the name remains. All Shankara's disciples will be called as Shankaracharya. That is the tradition. All Buddha's disciples are called as Buddha. So you don't know which Buddha is a person. Because they believe once a person becomes enlightened, he becomes one with that consciousness. He is no more a separate person, individual person. He becomes one with the truth. So it is enough if you remember the truth. There is no need to remember the individual person and the facts about his life. And I tell you one thing honestly, I spoke so much about him, but I can't give even a single incident which happened in his life, because there is no record. I can't say his father's name. I can't say his mother's name. I can't say where he is born. All I know is where he is buried. That's all. And how many books he has written? He has written 3 books. 3 books he has written. This is one of the important book. That's all we know. We don't know is how many years he lived. We don't know any other facts about him. There's a belief. The great truths should be kept away from the personality. The rishis, they believe it should be kept away from the personality. Apaurushya, in Sanskrit they call it. Apaurushya means no hero worship. The moment you bring hero worship, immediately the truth slowly gets diluted. The truth is tailored according to the hero. So in his case, he doesn't want truth to be tailored in course of time just to express his life. That is the reason. No fact about his life is recorded. He is hide himself so nicely. He is just forgotten except his name. Nothing about him is known. All we know is his discovery. That's all. And it's a pure attitude of a scientist. You see, you don't even have to know the name of Edison to use the light. All you need to know is how to switch it on and off. That's all. You don't need to know Edison's name or the letter on how many thousands of people have sacrificed to develop this. You don't need to know any of their names. All you need to know is how to switch it on or off. That's all. The same way, these people also wanted to keep themselves away from the philosophy, away from the truth, away from their discoveries. So they just totally moved themselves away, covered themselves, and presented only the great truths. That's the reason we are not able to get the details of his birth, or who is his master, how he could manage. And if you read his book, you will be shocked. You will be literally shaken. The way in which he analyzes, or way in which he expresses the truths about the mind, it is just unimaginable. The modern day psychologists, Sigmund Freud or Jung or this Adler, all these people look too small. I tell you honestly, not because I belong to this tradition or anything. I tell you honestly, I went through all these things. They look too small in front of him. Of course, it is not even the mistake of Sigmund Freud. Freud got only the patients as a specimen. He never got a single enlightened person to do research. All he got is only patients. So from patients, what data you can collect? Only based on those data, he could come to his conclusions. So it's not even his mistake. He did not get a single enlightened master. He did not have a chance. He didn't have. That is the reason. After 35 years of research, he comes to a conclusion. Man as such can't be healed. He says suffering is inevitable. Man as such cannot be in peace. He comes to a conclusion and he writes very clearly. If you read the books written by him in the last part of his life, he's very clear. Man as such cannot be healed. Man as such cannot be cured. And he says we can only analyze. If the guy gets bored and tired and gets frightened, he may say that I have become all right enough, stop. There is no other way. Yes, but fortunately, Patanjali had beautiful specimens to analyze, to collect data. He had some enlightened people around him, and he himself has become enlightened. The state of no mind. So naturally, he could bring more truths. He could express more great things about the mind and the spirit. Yes, your question.
Swamiji, would you explain something about the Vedantic philosophy and, you know, the concept about universal spiritual reality? It's similar to what you realize when you do the yoga. So that means that it proves the philosophy was right?
One thing, philosophy is right only after your experience, not when you read. Please be very clear. Vedanta says everything is God. Everything is God. There is nothing in the world which is not God. Everything is God. Everything is God, true. But we can't go and stand in the middle of the road. You can't say car is also God. And driver is also God. How can he destroy me? How can he disturb me? Everything is God only when you realize it. Only after your realization, not before. After your experience, not before. That's a beautiful story. Let me explain the story. One great teacher or a master is teaching to his disciples, everything is God. There is nothing in the world which is not God. The student learns everything. He is going to take bath in the river. Next day morning, he saw one mad elephant running towards him. All the people who were with him, they ran away. They escaped to save themselves. This guy, oh, yesterday only my master taught me. Everything is God. Why should I be afraid of this mad elephant? But the mouth, what do you call in English? The person who takes care of the elephant. Mouth, oh, same word. Oh, in Hindi only we call mouth. In Sanskrit we call mouth and mouth. This guy, he shouts, "Array, it's a mad elephant, run away, yes, save yourself." And this guy says, "No, everything is God, what is there?" He was standing. The elephant came and just took him and threw him. And he was lying almost half dead. After some time, the guru and all the disciples ran towards him and they wanted to help him. They asked him, "Fool, why did you stand in the middle? Why did you stand in the road? Why don't you run? Why didn't you run and save yourself?" He says, "No, no, you only told me everything is God. That's the reason. I just wanted to check what you said. When elephant is also God, why should I run and save myself?" Then the master says, "Yes, I told everything is God, that's true. But just like elephant is God, that mouth is also God. He told you, run and save yourself. He gave you the warning. God has already sent you a message. Why didn't I have enough intelligence to receive that message?" Many times, we don't realize the truth completely. Half truth is much worse than a lie. Please be very clear. Half truth is much worse than a lie. When I say half truth, unrealized truth is much worse than a lie. Unrealized truth is much worse than a lie. So, Vedanta is a truth, ultimate truth. That's true. No doubt. But when you start preaching or thinking it is truth without realizing it, then it's dangerous. Then it is very dangerous. So, Patanjali never speaks anything about truth. Because he's a seeker, he's a scientist. He never comes to a conclusion in the beginning. If you read the Upanishad, the first sutra itself will be a conclusion. And here, he gives you a beautiful method or a technique to reach the conclusion. So Patanjali is more like a scientist. And from my experience, I tell you, unless you experience, never think Vedanta is truth. Because when you experience, the truth is totally different than what you understand before experience. Before experience, the same word will mean totally different. And after experience, the same word will mean totally different. See, the master, when he speaks about Vedanta, he speaks from experience. Disciple, when he listens about Vedanta, he listens from unconsciousness. So the master's words, disciple's dictionary, how can it match? See, I speak based on particular dictionary and you refer, you understand based on a different dictionary. I speak based on different dictionary. And you take the same word and you refer and you take the meaning from a different dictionary. Naturally, there will be a problem. A small story. One lady, middle-aged lady, she was trying to wear a new fur coat and see how it looks on her in front of a mirror. She was standing and trying to adjust that fur coat. That small girl, her daughter, she said, "Mom, don't you realize how much that poor animal should, how the poor animal would have suffered for you to have this? You are torturing this poor animal for you to have this fur coat." His daddy just turned and said, "How dare you speak about your father like this?" She says, the daughter expresses about the animal which is supposed to give the fur. The mother understands. She is talking about the father who is supposed to give the money. Same word, you can understand from two different angles. The daughter means the animal. The mother understands the from the angle of, from different angle. She thinks it is about the husband who is supposed to give money. Same word, when master says, he means totally different. When you understand, you mean totally different. So better, if you don't believe Vedanta before you experience it, it is good for you and for others. If you start believing it before you experience, there is every possibility you will create confusion for yourself and others. And I have seen people who start believing before experiencing and start preaching also. Leads to all possible confusions and all possible dangers. So please be very clear. Even if it is truth, it is not your truth. It is the truth for the rishi who realized. Not for you. Let it become truth to you. Only then it is truth for you. Till it becomes truth to you, it can't be called as truth to you. Thank you. Yes. Alright, few minutes. This is the last question, we'll finish. We have only 5 more minutes. This is a wonderful question. Yes, this is a wonderful question. He says, can there be an organized method to reach the mind and to reach the mindless state? Because mind, how can mind itself go beyond the mind? And Patanjali himself answers. Now I will give you the gist of the answer. Tomorrow I will give the technique for this very specific question. See, like a, he gives a technique to evaporate the water. You see, as long as it's a water, as long as it's in the room temperature, you can never think the water can become steam. But once you put the fire, once you start heating, suddenly you see at one point, it's a vapor, it's a steam. It can't be called anymore as a water. Same way, he infuses different kind of energies into your mind, into your being. Automatically the mind evaporates. The mind evaporates. And one more important thing you should understand, you need to understand. As long as you are moving, your being is called as mind. The moment movement stops, the same being only becomes Atman, becomes divine. It's like a, as long as you are moving, you are in the chanchala means the movement, you can be called as a mind. The moment stops, the same thing will become divine. See, understand this one example. It's like a rope. The rope is there. It look like a rope, usually, and it can bind you. If you just burn that rope, it will exactly look like a rope after being burnt also, but it can't be used to bind you. Same way, the mind which is moving can bind you. If it stops moving, it may look like a mind, it cannot bind you. It can't be called as mind. It can't be called as mind. As long as it has got thoughts, only then it is mind. The moment thoughts stop, it can't be called as mind. And one more thing. The more you go deeper into the mind, slowly, the qualities of the mind, what you think as qualities of the mind, disappears. As long as you are in the superficial level, only then the oscillation. Too much of moving, wavering, this side and this side and this side and this side. The more you go deep, slowly, slowly, what you think as mind, as on now you think mind cannot guide you, mind is only confusion, mind is a disturbance, these are all truth now. Because too much of disturbance, the slowly, slowly when you settle down, the same mind will become guide. The same mind will become teacher. The same mind will lead you to no mind state. The same mind will lead you to no mind state. As on now, mind only moves you away from the enlightenment. Only that gives you all trouble. The moment you settle down, when you start going in, the moment you start experiencing the bliss inside, the mind only will pull you inside. That will give you the guidance. Now, it gives you, it just brings you out. It again and again brings you out. The moment you start experiencing the calmness or bliss inside, the same mind will use all its force and energy to take you in, to reach that no mind state. And ultimately, no mind state is not against mind. Please be very clear. Because we have no other word, we use the word no mind state. But the no mind state and the mind, they are not against each other. Mind exists because mind doesn't know that no mind state is an ecstasy. Mind has not tasted the no mind state. Because of that it exists. Otherwise, mind itself, once you start tasting that ecstasy, mind itself will ask you to stay in that state. Mind itself will want you to stay in the state. It's not against the no mind state. As of now, because it doesn't know, it distracts you. Mind is a wonderful servant. Whatever it thinks as a truth, it will take you there. That's all. It's a wonderful servant. Wonderful person. If it thinks the outer world is the truth, it will take you there. All you need to do is just give a one glimpse or a conscious awareness. The inner world is much more beautiful, blissful, great. The moment you manage to give that beyond your logical analysis, all these things, simply your mind will start taking you towards insight. So, tomorrow, please raise the same question, because I'll be giving a little deeper explanation how the mind works. This is the important question. Actually, Patanjali analyzes this question in the first chapter. In the first chapter itself, he says, how can one more dream take you beyond dreams? See, mind is a dream. And your practice or your sadhana, everything is one more dream. All your meditation techniques are one more dream. How can one more dream lead you to dreamless state? Yes. And he gives you the clear answer. The answer is, if you see a lion chasing you in your dream, automatically you will come out of the dream. Lion chasing you is only one more dream. But how did you come out of the dream? Just by that dream. So dream can lead you to dreamless state. You understand this one logic, you can understand. Dream can lead you to dreamless state. He gives the logic also. What type of dreams can lead you to dreamlessness? Can wake you up? Why? We'll see tomorrow. Thank you.